Welcome everybody here to your coverage of the Join Dota Masters. We are here for what is now our first semi-final. That is right, we have two of them to get through tonight. And actually, it's the first in two aspects. One, because it's the first semi-final out of two for this evening. And second, because this is the first Join Dota Masters Cup. We're going to also crown the victor of that one a little bit later on, but we need to find out who is going to get to the grand final. Will it be CLG, Canalogic Gaming, or will it be NextKZ? NextKZ, a up-and-coming team. Well, actually, they've been around for a crap load long time, but they are definitely an awesome team to keep our very, very close eyes on in the top end of the world of Dota. Let's jump ourselves in and welcome in our top end person. That is right, he is my co-commentator. He is from the creme de la creme. He is the Swiss cheese of the Denmark. It is Sindra, my co-commentator.
The Swiss cheese of the Denmark. Oh, you never cease to amaze me, man. Yeah, welcome everybody to Masters of NextKZ versus CLG. By the looks of it, both teams will be playing with a few stand-ins actually today. Only one for the Radiant side, which is NextKZ, but we will have two stand-ins on the Dire side, which is CLG. First pick is going to the Radiant side, so that's NextKZ's, as CLG got Dire. And the first ban coming out of Mantis, he didn't take long to figure out Beastmaster's the worthy ban, and you've got to say, CLG just love Beastmaster, and NextKZ, they know what they're up against.
Beastmaster's just one of those things that, you're right, CLG, they just love picking him up every single time he gets through in those first three. They generally take him in like that second or third slot, though. They don't always just like grabbing him first up. There's so many heroes you can take. But banned out, because we always see Invoker banned out by the team who doesn't have first pick. And Darkseer is also going to make it in the ban pool. Just want to point out right now, Chen, Prophet, still in the mix. Enchantress, Windrunner, still some very, very large heroes. And if you don't know the power of Windrunner just yet, you should have been tuning in to Valiant's live stream, which you can also find over at joindota.com, basically showed CLG's last game when they got ripped royal by the Windrunner, so they probably do not want to be facing that again. I'm just saying probably. They definitely don't want to be facing a Windrunner Shackle again. Completely screwed up all their team fights.
And the thing is, NextKZ have really adept Windrunner players, or at least one. I'm not sure who usually plays it, but whoever does an excellent job on that side. So I think it might be the pick that NextKZ are aiming for getting first. However, with CLG's hesitation here, they might want to give away a Prophet, which we usually see just banned out very quickly. But CLG might want to get a trade-off here, saying, all right, you can choose Windrunner or Prophet. We're going to get the other one plus one.
Yeah. Well, you could take Windrunner Chen if they grab out the Prophet, and they're going to ban out Windrunner.
Wow.
I'm actually surprised Pycat didn't just try and play chicken with him.
He's going to give them the choice, Chen or Prophet, and I'm 100% sure CLG is going to get the other one. The question is what the other pick is going to be, and I'm also 100% sure NextKZ will get Chen or Prophet.
Chen.
They choose the Chen. That's going to be a Prophet for Pycat. And as for the secondary pick they'll get, might see something like
Venom. Perhaps
Venno or Venge. Maybe even CM this early on. It's a great hero for Aka to play when both his Enchantress and Chen are gone, as NextKZ have banned Ench and picked Chen. So, might see CLG taking the CM already here. Either that, or maybe Shadow Shaman, one of Nikwa's very good heroes. He's a stand-in for them today. Might be playing the solo mid-roll. But they get the Tidehunter, big team fighter first.
Yeah, and that's actually a really smart choice when you say, because you mentioned the words VS. Every single time I hear the words VS, I think of Enigma at the same time. I know you debated yesterday, VS isn't the best counter all the time for him. But it is a really good pickup to grab if you pick up the Enigma as well. But a Tidehunter Ravage makes Enigma's black hole almost next to impossible unless he grabs Tide himself. And even then, you're not going to kill Tide in that time he's caught inside the black hole. But to grab even more pushing power, so Shadow Shaman's going to come up for Mantis. So you got wards as well as the Chen creeps. That tier 1 tower on the bottom lane is not going to last long at all. If it's even going to come there, it might even come in towards the middle lane. Gank him up, push the tier 1 tower in mid.
Yeah, the challenge for NextKZ right now is to figure out their laning, because when you give a Prophet away, your laning is always going to be weird. Because Prophet can always be there. That's just the power of Teleport. It's a global spell you can cast anywhere. And with that reasoning, when you think about it, if you're playing a tri-lane versus a tri-lane, the team with Prophet have 3.5 there all the time. If not, if you want to stretch it, you might even say they have 4 there all the time if they want to. So it's like, if CLG now, with the Prophet, have the choice of trying to take a lane fight 3-on-3 with the Prophet in backhand. Or, if they feel like doing so, they can also do dual lanes, and Prophet can just TP away all the time, knowing his lane is going to be guarded by, for instance, a Tide who gets the levels. And CM is going to be the pick for Mantis now, so I'm really interested to see what Ake is going to play. I don't recall seeing Ake playing anything else than CM, Enchantress, and Chen for 2 months. So, I'm not even kidding. I don't recall seeing him playing anything else.
I reckon he'll be on the Prophet.
I wasn't even exaggerating.
I actually reckon we're going to see a Jungle Prophet this
time
around.
That's Piecat Prophet, 100%.
You think?
Hands down, yeah. Unless if he's going to play hard carry, which you've got a point. With Loda absent, we might see Piecat on the Ricky, actually, that they picked up just now.
Mm-hmm.
So the other Prophet could be played by someone else. Maybe Ake as a support Prophet. I just don't think it's a role he's practiced a lot, but we'll see if it's what he decides to go for.
Yeah. Diversity in play is always something you got to try and promote. I love the fact, though, like just to look at from next KZ's lineup, picking up the Crystal Maiden. Crystal Maiden no longer really seen as like that mid-game mana pot. It's kind of like turned into aggression. Gotta love the Frostbite, gotta love the Nova, and to combine that with Chen and his creeps as well, you're gonna have yourself more than likely two guaranteed stuns coming out from those guys whenever they decide to gank around. And maybe then, this is what NextKZ is thinking, Prophet, sure, he can TP to any lane on the sun, any position on the sun, as long as he's explored the area, and that makes
it... He doesn't need to explore anymore. It's fixed in the latest version of Dota, and it should be...
It got modified?
Yeah.
Ooh.
The area undiscovered doesn't work anymore. It doesn't exist anymore. Unless if it's not implemented in Dota 2, I know it's fixed in Dota 1. You can teleport anywhere. You can also blink to fog.
That's more OP, man. But did that come out in the latest patch for Dota 1?
674, yes.
And okay.
I believe all the changes have been ported. I'm pretty sure they have.
Not until tomorrow. On tonight, in fact. When the new patch comes out, that's when the new changes happen to the newest version, and the tournament version updates to 6.73.
We're playing newest version here, right?
Yeah, we're playing newest version, but it hasn't...
Then I'm sure it should work like that, because I know Morphling, for instance, gets the new stats from skilling Morph.
Yeah, he does.
That's one of the newest patch. That's from the newest patch. That's from the same version.
In that case, they've changed over the Prophet then.
I'll keep an eye out for whether that happens or not, but it's definitely a groundbreaking change for a hero like Prophet, and also for a hero like Anti-Mage, who's not in the game right now, obviously banned, but he can blink to anywhere now, and it does matter. Morphling is now going to be the pickup for the Radiant here. Nice pickup. There's two things to note about this. First of all, next KZ will have strong laning. Maiden Morphling is a classic combo. It's got nice slow and stun for Morphling to waveform through, get some hits in, then even an adaptive strike if he chooses to skill that. And with Chen on the lane, they can really challenge. However, on the Dire side, I mentioned the Prophet. He is going to be a threat that they need to take care of. But the Sprout is not that good against Morphling. He can jump out of it with waveform. And they only have one stun, which is the Venge stun, which is pretty good, but not that long. And on top of that, the range heroes on the Dire side, who's going to harass Morphling? They've got Venge, Tide, and Ricky. Nobody can really go close. So that's going to be hard. And the final thing about Morphling, can replicate Ricky Maru. So if Ricky gets that Diffusal Blade, Morphling can take that copy. And the cool thing is, the copy he makes of Ricky goes invis as well.
Yeah, we're watching that yesterday being completely exploited, leaving Ricky Maru sitting inside the base waiting for one support hero. He just did like half be on low health and just like jump himself in and just destroy them. It's kind of harsh that way. I'm wondering who the last pickup for next KZ is going to be. And for some reason, I'm thinking Brood at this point. And
Toby won!
Thank you. Thank you. Syndrome gives me the power I need. But the main reason why I was thinking Brood Med is it must be thinking the same thing. They need a side lane solo hero, but they want a hero that can also push. Grabbing a hero like Puck is going to be too fragile at this point. So what's the best thing you can do? And what can also remove out that Sprout when it goes down? Keep a web up your sleeve. Morphling can get caught, but maybe just save the waveform. Now the hero might get caught, and all you got to do is just pop that web down, destroy off the trees, move yourself around nice and freely.
And I mean, this gives me a deja vu almost from our game against Na'Vi yesterday. The one that I was briefly talking to you about, in which we just were really owned from the draft, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't say CLG are in as terrible position, but I'd say either next KZ have been watching Na'Vi and really tried to adapt to what Na'Vi have introduced, which, without giving Na'Vi too much credit, they're really doing a lot for the scene, like in how we draft. They have been, well, since Dota 2 has come out, they've been controlling a lot about how the metagame is going, like what works and what doesn't. And they had, in the game against us, they also had Brood and Morphling. And what they did is, Brood on one lane, Morphling on the other, constant pushing. They played some other solos, but I believe if Na'Vi could have got their hands on it, they would have got the Chen as well. So what we actually see here is a really solid draft from Next KZ. Lots of pressure. On the other side, CLG, great team fight, good carry, good presence with the Prophet. But they have triple melee and a short-range Venge. Can they get the damage done in the lane phase? Because if they don't succeed early on, and if Next KZ do, you have no idea what kind of pressure you're playing under when you're playing against Morphling and Brood. That's just brutal. And then you throw in a Chen. Like,
yeah,
it's going to be really harsh. I've got to say, I'm really loving Next KZ's draft right now, and I'm loving CLG's as well. And I've, Prophet will be playing a big, big role in this one. And you weren't right. It's not Aki playing Prophet. I might as well go for the CLG heroes. You can take Next KZ. I hope that's all right with you.
Wunderbar!
On CLG, Pycat, no big surprise there, is going to be handling the Rikimaru. We've got Aki playing on the Vengeful Spirit. Nikwa will be playing as the Nature's Prophet. Smulgulig playing as the Tidehunter. And finally, Miracle will be playing as the Sand King, moving up towards the top lane here together with Tide. I wonder what the laning plans are for CLG. Are they going to do? They're going to do some really strange stuff right here. But if the lanes are right, if they guess out the lanes from Next KZ right, this might be the best laning they can do.
Yeah, I think they kind of know. I'll go through Next KZ in a moment. They know the Brood is going to want to end up on the top lane. Well, that's what they were. That's what they're at least thinking. Morphling on the safe bottom lane is definitely going to work for them. But the pushing power that can also come out from a Brood Chen is going to be pretty nuts. So the normal thing whenever you see a Brood, put either SK or Tide right in front of him. But Tide's also going Gush. There's no Anchor Smash. It's a very aggressive combo for the skill build for Miracle and Smuggling very early on. So yeah, we'll watch that one very, very... Oh, what the... No. Are they seriously thinking... No, they're checking. It's just a check. Okay. They thought maybe Roshan was going to be attempted. But let's run through the next KZ, guys. So Mantis will be taking the role of Shadow Shaman. Ikor will be taking up Broodmother, who is going to head up towards that top lane. Down the bottom lane, Lucky takes up Chen. Normally see him with the Chinese characters, but luckily for this, he has changed his name. The pun was not intended, but he has changed his name, so we do know what he's called. Storm will be taking the role as the Crystal Maiden, and that leaves our last one. He is the boy from Germany, and is RMM playing Morphling on the bottom lane. So the lanes do go to what I thought they were going to. We don't see anything unusual.
Apart from the Dire, because this is not what you would normally expect to see, but it's a consequence of the picks of the Radiant. Playing a Tide Sand King lane is, when you think about it, it's really strange, right? But against Brood, it's a great choice. Sand King doesn't... Oh, they don't have sentries. Whoa. They don't have sentries.
Either the heroes didn't buy them? No, we got Observer Wards.
Yeah, that's not good for them, because what CLG want to do here, they're guessing Brood is going to go top and that Morph is bottom, and they're absolutely right.
Yeah.
So what they want to do about the Brood is they want to sentry him out and just challenge him on the lane all the time. Gush, Sand King stun, and just harass him away so he can't go to the creep wave. The moment Sand King starts getting up Caustic Finale, it's going to be very, very hard for Equal to do so much on this lane. But without the sentries, he's perfectly fine. They have nothing on him.
And that's a big problem. It was actually something we're talking about with Puppy when Na'Vi played up against DTS in the show match. And I was saying, well, basically at this... Oh, hello, Brood. He's still taking a lot of damage. He's got to be careful. But you're right. No sentry. That would have been first blood. That would have been first blood if there was a sentry. SK to follow through with the strike, and all Tide need to do is getting close enough to land in one last right click, and that would be the death of Equal.
Mm. Yeah, I think this might be some miscommunication on the CLG side, because this is not what they were aiming for.
Yeah.
Still, Tide is going to be able to pull, and I've got to say, whoever of these two guys up top gets 200 gold the first needs to buy the Sentry Wards. Miracle has them now, has the gold. Just see Equals actually pressuring Miracle here, because Tide is not there, he's pulling.
Mm-hmm. Well, why wouldn't you? You've got Spawn Spilings as well as a Spin Web. The Web giving you extra regen, so you can be a lot more aggressive, and you don't have to use as much consumables, and you try and force them out from the heroes in the top lane. The only downside for Broodmother is...
Equal.
What?
He's trying to pull the big creep spawn, but as it goes invis in the web, they just ignore him. That's not planned.
The funny thing is, I was watching that, I still didn't understand the joke. Ba-dum-bum-bump.
Toby won.
Yeah. Thanks, man. Thanks. Yeah. I haven't played that song in a while. Yeah. Anyway. Treants, scouting out on the bottom lane. It's a hard lane for a Prophet, but as long as he gets levels... I'm going to finally get back to my point. I've gone a complete circle around. Maybe you have to wait a second while Mage is going to get initiated on Magic Missile starting off, and the Blink Up as well as Backstab from Pycat, almost killing your Shadow Shaman, but that's the last of his consumables. Forced to use the pot already. He's not going to be happy with that. But yeah, he is having the bottle walking out. I would say it was flying out. I'll only hear the clip-clops.
Yeah, this is what CLG need to do with the laning. When they're playing this dual lane mid, take the fight to Shadow Shaman. Really pressure him. Rip him off his regen, And hopefully that's going to give Pycat a much, much better lane positioning right now. Arcane knows there's a regen top. He's going to take this. And he's back perfectly fine with full mana. And they're going to keep pressuring Mantis. And until Chen helps out, Mantis won't be getting too much in this mid lane. He's, however, focused on bottom lane. And this is the question. How do CLG deal with this? They're getting pushed on bottom. Brood is fine up top. Now the sentries are there. That's good. That helps them a lot. Miracle is now in control of the lane. But the push on bottom, how do they respond?
Well, how do you respond? We don't have level 6 up in Prophecy. You don't have that option to destroy the creep wave. And you're either forcing SK or Tide to come down here. But if you do that, then you're also facing a couple of stuns or at least some nukage coming his way. And then they can't throw SK into that. And, well, you are right, man. Just sitting back at his tower. But again, it's another hollow engagement. I think it's just more distraction. Try and hold him there so more support can't come in. And Prophet TP's down towards the bottom lane, using a normal TP scroll, and just tries to hold the line.
Oh, Niqua!
He's in too far.
That could have been dangerous, but he's got two gauntlets. So that extra 6 strength is doing a lot for him in terms of survivability on the bottom lane.
Yeah, and he's going to be getting that urn up as fast as he possibly can. I think he realizes just how important it is for his team to keep on pushing, and low life is not going to be something he wants to fall back for. So look to get these kills. Not to mention he can also just TP in to get the urn charges, then TP back out again. 20-second cooldown, level 4 TP. Hell yeah. 2 urn charges for one set of mana. 45. Still 4 minutes in. Very, very different style for NSKZ compared to what they were forced to play yesterday. Yesterday we were basically going at 2 to 3 kills per minute. And today we now hit the 4-minute mark, and Pycat having some fun here with Mantis, and Mantis realizing he can't turn around to run away from Pycat when he's got a DD in the backstab. So the best thing he can do is just turn around, turn him into a chicken and Aethershock him.
Yeah, and that Aethershock is doing a lot of damage, and Pycat will probably have to pop the healing salve here, and that means the middle lane is out of regen. He isn't indeed going to use it right now. And Ake is
empty.
Yeah, he's pretty empty. I'm not sure if he's why he's going back here. He's got full mana. He might be heading toward
bottom.
And this is the thing. Like, next KZ, keeping the pressure up, and the top lane is not suffering for it. Equals level 5.
Hang on, we're going to double rotate. Pycat's coming in with the remainder of the DD rune, and they're going to be forced to fight on top of the tier 2 tower. So Salorbi about the blink and smoke. Where's he going to go for? More than likely, once I remember, CM's going to be the easier target, and that's the one he does blink onto. Smoke goes up, so Storm forced to fight it, but they will manage to bring down the CM for the VS, and a pause in the game here from Morphling. I don't know what's going wrong.
He's just, his hero is rotating and he looks like he's trying to cast something, but he's doing absolutely nothing with that Morphling. And that's not good for Iron Man. He might be picked off from this. He's even skilled attribute bonus. Okay.
I don't know, yeah.
Like, skilling attribute bonus in Morphling right now is totally pointless because of the buff on Morph. The first time you skill Morph, you get 3 strength and 3 agility. Then on level 2 it gives 4, level 3 it gives 5, and level 4 it gives 6. So getting attribute bonus over that makes no sense, and I'm not sure if it's during this whole lag thing or crazy thing going on with RMN that he skilled attribute bonus, but might show us that something is going wrong. Mm-hmm. But 1-for-1 exchange, who got the first blood? Dire. Yeah? Radiant got it first. They got Aki first.
Really?
So first blood gold also going to the Radiant. Yep.
So V has actually died first. Mm.
And Equals calling out, it seems like internet he's dropped from Skype, so that's not good for RMN. Even if he comes back in, I don't think he can escape this. You can try to waveform out, and maybe Chen can pull him out.
That's
if he gets
true.
A good waveform off and pulling him out, he could get away, because Tide is TPing in now, but that gush is not going to be enough. We'll need a hit or two from Pycat, but he's got cooldown on his abilities, and Prophet can't do anything if he jumps. So I actually think RMN will survive this, just on the edge.
Mm. By the way, I'm having to look at the middle lane for people wondering what I'm doing with my camera, because if I look top, I hear Tidehunter's TP, and if I look down towards the bottom lane, I'm hearing where he's TPing too. And it gives us that.
If you look at top, you can also hear Sand King sandstorming.
Yeah. Where's my hay bale? And look how much money he's getting from that. The spider's just on top of him. All I'm seeing is like this 12, 13, 13, lottery numbers! 13, 13, 13 million dollars! Alright, so hopefully RMN does get himself back inside the game. It is a small concern. We can at least check out at the rest of our graphs as well as the CS. As far as XP goes, I don't think anybody He's going to enjoy what that looks like. It's a rocky kind of pass on the XP graph. The gold graph, however, says something very, very different. Even with only one T1 tower going down, a 2,000 gold advantage going the way of Next KZ, it did kind of level itself out for a moment after that one kill. On the kill of the tower, which is actually slightly surprising that that leveled out instead of boosting it up. How are we looking for CS-wise? Alright, hopefully he can't get back in again. I keep on saying the same thing. Hopefully we do see the normal him come back in the game. 28 for 1 though, RMM. So he's actually doing pretty damn decent. In fact, he's the most farmed hero on the map. 1,700 yep. gold him on him as well, which he does not want to lose. It's going to click on him now. How much of that is... It's all unreliable gold by 199. No, 34, sorry. 34 reliable gold is all he's got.
How did he get reliable gold?
I think the initial gold you get at the start of the game is reliable gold.
Is that?
I believe so.
Yeah, it might be. That's the only reliable gold he could have got. He didn't even get the assist because he was disconnecting. Else, I think he would have taken the first blood on Venge with a waveform.
Mm-hmm. It might be forced to... Like, if he can't get back into the game, we might be forced to have ourselves a remake. For those guys out there, we're going to split up the VOD right now because he might reconnect back in about one moment or in about 15 minutes, but we don't know. So for now, for the people on the VOD, this could be the end of part one, but part two will be coming up in just a moment.